Tigers fans in Cleveland would love to have that. And I think, yes, when you start looking at last year, it was probably Russell Westbrook and Kevin Durant. Now people will argue, is it Steph Curry and Kevin Durant? But they haven't played together. And I think championships means a lot. So I would say right now, I give my nod to LeBron James and Kyrie Irving.
Right. Well, this is the very first moment, I guess, the first moments that we're watching of their real training camp from right here at the Cleveland Clinic courts. And you talk about those 1-2 punches in the NBA because the conversation can head towards Steph and Clay. Now it's potentially Steph and KD. Was it KD and Russ? And now that is no longer. But these two guys, having done what they did in the NBA Finals, it has to solidify that.
And the way they did it. I mean, the one thing I love about LeBron James, he understood, and he understands the game so much, is when to take over and when let Kyrie take over. Phenomenal what they did from game 5 through 6 and 7, and obviously those last few plays defensively for LeBron James and offensively for Kyrie Irving.
So the question now can become, can this guy, LeBron James, not only carry this team to yet another NBA Finals, which would be his 7th consecutive appearance, or is he going to have to do everything that he's going to have to do to get this team back there? Has he now, I guess, handed over the reins to guys like Kyrie to be able to do so?
Kristen, it's so funny. We were just talking before we came on air. We're looking back at stats, and you look at his numbers from the Finals last year. Those are gaudy numbers, but then you want to go back and say the year before was no Kyrie Irving, no Love. I don't know if that will ever be repeated. Only thing was left.
He had to do most of that work himself. He was averaging 35.8 points, 13.3 rebounds, and 8.8 assists a game. That was a guy who literally had to do it all.
I mean, it was phenomenal to him to be able to carry that team without those guys and give the coaching staff credit that year, but also
certainly a lesser version of ourselves defensively too many nights last year. As we started to play better in the playoffs, I think we paid a little bit more attention to detail in that way. But we certainly weren't the team that we're capable of being on the defensive end. You're seeing Shumpert now. He's a big part of the reason for that. Shump's in great shape. He's really dedicated himself to that. I think he was going through some issues from an injury standpoint last year when he first came back that made it so he wasn't quite as menacing on that end as he could be. And I think several guys last year, Kevin Love included, coming off the surgery that he was, weren't quite what he's capable of being either. So, again, as I said, we're expecting growth from within on both sides of the ball, but I'd like to see us really commit to the defensive end with more consistency.
What did you add to this team with the acquisitions of Chris Birdman Anderson and Mike Dunleavy as well?
Mike Dunleavy was somebody that we were really excited about adding, and we would have liked to have added even in the previous season. His size on the wing, his basketball IQ, his shooting ability, you know, from a metric standpoint, he shoots about as well as you can. We're going to have to build and get better every day, and the guys understand that. And our conference is radically improved. It's going to be a very difficult game almost every night in our conference now, and that's something that I think our guys are aware of. So we won't get too high, we won't get too low, which is something Bron always preached as well. So I think our players are of that now. They know what the job really takes and what's really required. But I also think it's important that we have guys that are really hungry and amped up and remind them of what it looks like to have not won. So,
David, you know, fans mean so much. But for this city, the Cleveland Cavaliers, to win a championship, it was just ecstatic and people were going crazy. Can you just talk about, still to this day, the vibe and the feel of the city of Cleveland after you guys brought a championship home?
It's a special feeling to get to be part of. You know, you feel like your legacy will, no matter what happens the rest of your career, you'll have those moments, and knowing what the team has helped do for the city, what ownership did in investing at the level they did to bring this about.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.
You guys, again, can continue watching this broadcast simulcast on Facebook at facebook.com/NBA TV. We are here until, what, at least noon. Correct.
I guess Chris, I'm going to get in the gym right now. I didn't feel what I was shirtless.
He sees Kyrie shirtless. All of a sudden, he's in here doing push-ups. Like, what's happening here? What, though, do you see as the importance of this first day of training camp as they're getting out there? I mean, he mentioned it. David mentioned it to us, avoiding complacency, getting out there from the get-go and setting the tone for what could be a back-to-back championship.
Yeah, I think you said it best, complacency. I think also for this team to understand is you've got to go even harder right now. The Bullseye will always be on a LeBron James-led team. But when you add a championship right now, will be more pressure for them. And I think for them is right now is attention to details and let it start off from day one. You don't want to get hit in the mouth and you don't understand how to get out of this rut. I think starting right now, you might not see them going hard, but so much of right now is coming down with the lingo and the language and what you guys want to do and really listening to T. Lou. Last year, T. Lou didn't get a chance to run training camp. Now he gets to put his imprint in everything he wants them to do. So I think right now, the first few days of training camp is huge for the Cavaliers.
It's going to be a light day, all right? This morning, it's going to be a light day. We want to make sure we're mentally prepared, all right? There's a lot of mental stuff. We're doing what we're trying to do and get better. We're going to add a couple new offensive sets, you know, out of our slice and out of our punch. And then we're going to walk through how to defend it. And there's some 3-on-2, 2-on-1s, you know, and a lot of shooting. So just be mentally prepared.
Automatic on three, work on six. 1, 2, 3.
Automatic. Stephen Curry, Draymond Green, and KD. This puts an emphasis on him is where he's going to have to be the help guy, but he's guarding a lot of guys out on the floor. But on the other end, he has to punish them.
I asked Tristan a couple of days ago the same question I just asked you about how KD changes that matchup for him, and he laughed and he said, it's just somebody else I need to switch out on the pick and roll. Without Andrew Bogut in that Warriors lineup, without Festus Ezeli in that Warriors lineup as well, do you think that the Cavaliers have now gained an advantage inside?
Well, I'm going to go back and tell Tristan Thompson, KD is not just another guy you're just switching
right,
out
yeah.
on to. This is a guy that can average right. 30 and has averaged 30. But it does give them an advantage on the front court, I think, right now. I think right now with no Bogut, no Festus Ezeli, no Maurice Spates, you're talking about size.
Right.
And then you're talking about some guys coming in, Zaza Pachulia and David West. But you still have to have that chemistry. I think chemistry-wise and been through it, and these guys together, when you start talking about even Birdman, he's played with LeBron James before, so he can get the terminology and he understands LeBron. So I think they have the advantage. As far as with Tristan Thompson and Kevin Love and Channing Frye and those guys been being together.
Well, you and I will be on NBA TV Saturday night, and all of you fans watching are going to want to watch Saturday as well, because you can watch Kevin Durant's very good back to real training camp for the Cleveland Cavaliers from the Cleveland Clinic courts. Alongside the NBA champion Steve Smith, I'm Kristen Ledlow. That guy's got a lot to laugh about these days. The three-time NBA champion LeBron James looking to lead his guys to what could be yet another one in June, but it's a long way off. It is still September, so we've got a little while to go. Let's look back, though, at how they were able to bring a championship to the city of Cleveland for the first time in franchise history.
And the way they did it, and it was obviously throughout a lot of different plays, but the block by LeBron James.
I wanted to ask you, because we have dissected those last 2 minutes of that Game 7 countless times in the last 90 days, but walk me through that block with LeBron, because he came up huge on the defensive end of the floor, averaging nearly 2.5 blocks a game during the NBA Finals this season. How is it that he was able to get from the point he was?
Kristen, great question. And we've always talked about LeBron James. And we talked about it when I got a chance to interview him. To block it on that side, but also was prepared to not contest it on the left side, to block it on both sides, which to me, he had him all set up and planned to be able to contest both sides. Only thing left was Andre Iguodala to stop pump fake. He had, if he had the presence of mind, it's easy to say, is to jump back in LeBron and draw a foul.
Well, then let's reverse it. If you are Andre Iguodala, when you get the ball at the point that you do and you're headed the other way, do you at any point see LeBron? Have you already taken your mental picture of the floor, eliminated LeBron?
Let me hold it down, Jay. Let me get this done over and done with. Communication is the key to success. Come on, LD. Come on, communicate. 1, 2, 3.
Yes, sir. To stay status quo where the level he is, and I think he has to go to another level.
It seems to have gotten quieter around here, which is funny because they are the reigning champions, but you've got a lot going on at Golden State. You've got a lot going on in New York. You've got a lot going on in Chicago. I mean, the list can go on and on as to what happened this offseason, but there was no major addition to this Cavalier roster, so when you look at what has happened at Golden State with the acquisition of Kevin Durant, arguably one of the best two or three players in the league right now, what is it going to be seen as the key to the Cavaliers being able to continue to match up with a team that likely could have gotten significantly better? Is it going to be the development of these younger players?
I think so. I think Kate Felder is going to be huge without Mo Williams, without Matthew Dellavedova. He's going to come in and have to be able to not only offensively but defensively and being able to tell you about his injury. just the way he was moving around. He wasn't moving around fluidly last year, so I think he wasn't ready.
GM David Griffin did tell us a couple of days ago they've made a very aggressive offer and hope to get that deal done soon. We've got a whole lot more coming from the Cleveland Clinic courts right here as Real Training Camp continues on NBA TV.
4 miles doesn't sound real to me.
And I think we went further than four.
We did. 4.5. But we're all about accountability, too. So next time, we're holding you to it.
That's right.
Gotcha.
You are with us next time. Allie, though, this is now, I mean, you have been here for multiple seasons. You were here before LeBron James returned home. You are here now after an NBA championship. What's the difference between this season and last?
I think this is obviously practice number two of training camp. It's still very early, but there's a hunger. And there's a focus that you can already see, that you can already feel sitting inside practice with these guys. No matter what happened in June, you would almost never guess this team won a title just from the sense of, let's get back to work. You know, and that focus is there. I think you start out with number six right there, number 23, of course, LeBron, and it just trickles down. A guy like Kyrie, who's made it very clear as well, they want to go after another one.
From a David Blatt and then a T. Lou coach team, especially in the fire, in the playoffs, especially around the championship.
I don't think any former player can't agree or disagree.
You're talking about guys are comfortable. Mm-hmm. Talk about the additions. Some of the new guys, especially Kay Farrell, is a rookie. How's he fitting in with these guys and how are those guys bringing him along so far?
What I like about Kay Felder, and I think he said it best yesterday, is he wants to be a sponge. Here's a rookie who is willing to work hard, work his tail off, not back down from anything. He wants to be challenged. He wants to compete. He loves and is thriving under having a guy like Kyrie be his leader and be the guy that teaches him this game. And I don't think you can ask for a better guy than Kyrie to be able to do that. You see him right here. He's constantly taking.
A guy who's been around, but he's new to this. Mike Dunleavy, how do you see him fitting in with this Cavaliers offense? Can you see him playing a little bit of four because of his size and his shooting ability is some? I think you look at the Cavs, they have Kyrie, they have J.R. Smith. But adding another shooter like Mike Dunleavy takes this team to another level.
That, what you saw down the stretch with Kev, mentally letting go and just going out there, putting himself in positions to succeed and not worrying about anything else that came with it. How his body felt, where he was getting shots, how he was getting those shots. He just simply played the game. He can play inside out. He put on some weight this summer, good muscle. And so I think his ability to maybe establish still on the inside first and then be able to space out, that's Kevin Love.
Allie Clifton, thank you so much.
I have an assignment for
you. What is it?
You know, later on in the year, I want you to be able to write down all of Birdman's tattoos.
You want to know what I want?
All the tattoos.
One of those shirts where it's,
where it's like the actual cat, like the J.R. Smith.
That's what we need.
We can work on that.
We need
I
that.
I want to know but all the tattoos.
I'll do the assignment.
The meetings.
Well.
Yes.
The meetings. I like that. And can we please talk about the one on his kneecap?
Yeah, that could not have felt good.
Impressive.
Toughness.
No way that felt okay.
Allie, thanks so much for joining us. We'll let you get back to practice. We've got a whole lot more coming from the Cleveland Clinic courts.
Love, they didn't win it. And then last year down 3-1. What do you think was the difference for them to be able to get a chance to get over that hump to beat the Golden State Warriors, the same team that they had just lost to?
Oh, my goodness. You know, it was a lot of things. Of course, health is the main thing. But the second thing had to be the redefining of roles. Kyrie Irving is what we call an attack guard. You know, everybody's trying to make him a traditional point guard. He's not that. He's a great scorer. And, Steve, you are a scorer, and you understand that Kyrie scores easy.
Very easy.
There's only a couple more like him, right? Durant and Harden. Now, it would be LeBron, but he's double and triple teamed all the time. There's only three guys in our league that score easy. And he's one of them. So, you know, rather than try to make him something he isn't, lucid, hey, early offense, early in the clock, in transition, before they can get set and match up in the backside on the defensive side. And, you know, one-on-one, he's a monster.
You mentioned Durant.
Yes.
How does that matchup change now if we're looking at not just Christmas Day, but potentially the third season in a row, an NBA Finals rematch between the Cavs and Warriors? How does that change things with KD out in the Bay?
They've got to figure some things out. And it's attitudinal stuff. Come on, Klay is sacrificed, and I still think he's their best player. You know, he does so much for that team, and he plays both ends. And I think and to ask him to sacrifice more, I don't know if you can do that. I mean, but can the MVP get 30 a game and Durant get 27? No. somebody's got to get. You can't ask Draymond because he's a facilitator. So they've got some things to overcome. And all I know is we match up very well against them.
When you watch the Cavs coming into this game,
yes,
you know they've been together. They won a championship. But looking back just to last year, yes, obviously we're nitpicking from a team that won a championship twice. What area do you still look that they need to improve in and you'd like to see them improve?
Well, our weakness last season is that we would get leads on teams, but we couldn't maintain them. Two things have happened. And the first one is on the defensive end. We're a better defensive team. We've got Bird.
Would you like to see another acquisition at the point guard position behind who you described the attack guard, Kyrie Irving? Are you satisfied with potentially the Jordan Craig, Kay Felder competition for some of those minutes? Or would you like to see someone else pulled in from the outside in light of the Mo Williams announcement?
Well, I don't think you have to hurry, you know, because LeBron can play that spot. You don't want him to do that all year. I heard you talk about the fatigue factor. You don't want him to do a whole bunch of extra stuff, especially early in the year. But I do think that you know, David Griffin, I mean, you got to give the guy credit. Tremendous amount of pressure. Come on, LeBron James comes back, you know, and we have an owner who wants to win a championship.
Right.
Tremendous, and he's got his book open. So you got to make the right moves, Steve. And so far, this guy has made all the right moves. And I just think that you just have to be patient. See where we're at. You know, maybe go around a little bit to see how the rest of the league is playing. But there's no need to panic.
Well, my question is, Jim, we talk about, Kristen just asked you about adding somebody.
Yes.
J.R. Smith, talk about what he brings to this team. And for some reason, he doesn't re-sign back with the Cavs. What are you missing in J.R. Smith?
Well, you know, I understand my pay grade, so that's not my worry. But he got better last year because he played both ends. You know, and it was hard for Shumpert, I think, to move him out because he was so consistent. He spreads the floor. Everybody knows that. And then he's edgy. You know, intimidation is a factor in our league. You know, Birdman's going to bring that. And JR is a physical, emotional guy, and I think that plays on guys. You know, and so, you know, when he gets back, and you know, we'll be even better. But I do believe the strength of this team has been the improved bench with the veteran experience.
You see these guys in the first few hours of training camp. What's been the biggest difference that you've noticed between this season and last?
Well, LeBron, you know, it's all about LeBron with us. You know, we know who the man is. You know, there's no discussion. And it's not just in name only. You know, he gets it done. And everybody else follows. It makes it so much easier. Now we have a rising star, Kyrie Irving. Is a monster. He's been doing that since he was a rookie, Steve.
Right, right.
You know, even when we had those bad teams, if we could stay within 10, we knew, and they knew, in the fourth quarter, Kyrie was going to score.
In Kyrie, if LeBron's minutes, regular season minutes, are to take a step back like they did last season, that Kyrie is able to lead this team offensively?
Yeah, but I don't think it's so much terminology as leading, as much as being able to shoulder the load if possible or if needed.
Right.
You know, as long as he's healthy and, you know, you're always knocking on wood about everybody's health, you know, he can carry us. He can carry us a long way. But you got to watch his minutes, too.
Jim, a question for me is, yes, you've been around this team.
Because based upon their personnel, individually, you know, they're not that tough. But collectively, they play a pretty strong brand of team defense. And then Indiana's going to be better. You know, they're going to be better. You know, George is talking a lot, so he's got to prove it on the floor, you know. But I just think that we're so far ahead of everybody else because of our big three. Come on, there's not a power forward in the league that can go inside, outside like Kevin Love and make pressure free throws. There's just not one there. You know, LeBron is the best player in our game. You know, he does everything. Best all-around player of all time. You know, some people may say Oscar, but I tell you what, I watch this guy. He gets it done. And Kyrie, he scores easy. Those are three guys that teams have to match up with every night, and they can.
Jim, thanks so much for taking the time to join us. We appreciate it. Welcome back into the Cleveland Clinic courts. Steve Smith, I'm Kristen Ledlow. Smitty, a drill involving the entire team here.
What I love about this, Kristen, is that you get a chance. It's a defensive drill. A lot of times you see the first unit, and then you have the second unit, then you see the third unit. The sky blue uniforms, and they use basically both courts. You have the coaching staff having all these guys working. Before we got a chance to see this, it was a continuous drill where they were coming in, forcing the pick and roll down, and then obviously get through dribble handoffs. And what I love about it, you got to have guys on the same page, and everything is clicking. Everybody's talking, and a lot of times players get a chance to be on that sideline and get a little bit bored. Right now the Cavaliers are locked in defensively, and I think that's where David Griffin talked about it. I know T. Lou and his coaching staff, Larry Drew, they want them to even be better in that area than they were last year.
How important are these kind of drills during training camp when you get the entire team involved, when you get a chance to see groups one through three together?
Well, I think the one thing, Kristen, is if we haven't played together, I get a chance to understand and hear your voice. It's loud. I got to be able to say that's Kristen Letlow's voice.
Right.
That's my teammate's voice. When we're in these drills, get a chance to talk. And when we get through screens, how do you like it? Do you want me to let you through? You want me to push him out? Just to have those signals and that understanding. As you can see, four guys that play together, you're on that page. You don't have to talk about it, but I know for Kay Felder, a rookie, and some of the guys like Mike Dunleavy, you just got to get used to guys. And the hardest part is defensively versus the offensive end.
And a voice that they're hearing a lot, Tristan Thompson, becoming more of a vocal leader. We've got a microphone on him. Here's what he had to say.
Go warm up. Let's get these misses out the way. Jay Camp, day two.
I ain't really know why he laid jump about
it. I feel you.
I'm trying to watch them because I'm trying to watch Kevin and make sure I'm doing the same thing. And I go up, keep bringing
on. You never play video games? You never play video games when you hit the flip? Like you?
No, I never.
Oh, in Madden, when you flip play. Madden, when you flip play.
Lift up, Kale.
Yeah, I got a 2-9. Got a 2-9. Ice. High hands. Open up right here.
Second most in the NBA, and I don't have the list in front of me, but I'm going to assume the Golden State Warriors rank first on that list. But they're also giving up a lot of threes. 34.7%. from the three-point land against their opponents. Do you want to see things improve on the perimeter?
Help them in Kay Felder. He will be able to pressure the basketball. Different defender than Dellavedova. Dellavedova is more of a half-court, rugged, beat-you-up point guard once you got in half-court. But Kay Felder will be able to put pressure on out to half-court and turn off T. Lou in the huddle. And he said, well, this will be a light practice, more of a mental day. And then, you know, when the juices get to flowing,
right,
and he's ending practice. I like that. I like the coaches that end the practice with intensity versus the coaches that start off with intensity, then you go kind of lax a days ago at the end of the practices. Right now, they're ramping it up, and that's the way you want to leave the floor. And I think all coaches, I love it, you end on defensively, and that's what they're doing right now so far.
Training camp is significantly different these days than it was when you were playing.
Yeah,
correct?
I kind of understand it, Kristen.
Do you see the benefit of doing things the way they're done now as opposed to the way that they were when you played?
I think health-wise and guys saving their legs, per se.
Explain, though, to the fans who not know what training camp used to be
I think now they might have about two, maybe two-a-days, where we had probably 16 two-a-days.
Worth of two-a-days.
We had more people in camp, and I think it was more competitive because it was so long and so many different guys. But I understand right now, and they've done all the studies as far as saving your legs and rest. It's just different for me to get a chance to watch guys, you know, not going hard for 14 days, two-a-days versus three or four. They're saving their legs now.
We've talked a little bit about the Vegas odds. They now have the Golden State Warriors winning 10 more games than the Cleveland Cavaliers, despite being the reigning champions, and 10 more games than the San Antonio Spurs as well. When you think team to beat, who are you looking towards?
Out of all the teams, I think the champs. And I think, obviously, the Spurs, they're getting left off. And, yes, they're missing a big part in Tim Duncan, but you added a Pau Gasol. People forgot. They won a lot of games last year as well, 67.
And there was a lot of people in this organization that were really late that night. Front office coaches, players thinking, what's going on here? What are we doing? What's going wrong? And to get from that point at the end of March to 1.3 million people or 1 million, you know, however many people were out here, June 23rd, almost to the day, you know, 2 or 3 months later, it was a remarkable turnaround.
Jason, when you watch this team in training camp, I know it's been just 2 days. What's your storylines after you get a chance to watch them for the last 2 days?
Well, you know, David Griffin's mentioned this a couple times, but everything at the top of the roster is so set. There's some, but there's actual some openings at the bottom of the roster. You know, I think Dellavedova's that's a big loss for them because just the fire that he brought really to practice more than anything else, and he was such a knockdown 3-point shooter. The way that they were structured. You know, with his catch and shoot 3-point numbers, he was shooting 50%, and he was always open because there was so many other weapons on the floor he had to worry about. So
J.R. Smith, sure. 204 threes last season, very important to the offensive system here in Cleveland. What's the latest on his contract situation?
Yeah, you know, J.R. is represented by Rich Paul, who obviously represents LeBron as well, and Tristan Thompson, and they took the Tristan holdout all the way up to the start of the regular season last year. It's a different situation now because J.R. is unrestricted. He could go elsewhere. Three-year, $45 million deal. All of them said no, that they wouldn't trust him to go that long. So that's where they're stuck right now because, you know, JR's agents can go to the Cavs and say, hey, you need this guy. You got to pay him. You got to give him what we want. And the Cavs can say, well, you're right, we do. But you try and get that three-year deal, four-year deal that you're seeking elsewhere, you're not going to be able to find it. So the rest of the teams around the league just don't trust JR enough to give him the long-term deal that he's seeking because right.
People.
Oh, that's a lot of money. So Kay's on the team. You don't pay that much money to cut a guy. So Kay's on this team. If he was a few inches taller, it would help his cause, certainly. And he's got to become a better three-point shooter. He's not a very good three-point shooter right now. The Cavs aren't really concerned about that. They think it's a matter of just acclimating himself to the distance that'll come. What he is really good at is getting in the lane. He's very athletic. He's explosive. And the Cavs seem to think that he's got a little bit of that Dele quality inside of him. That
championship hangover. And where will there be had to say, what's the mentality, what's the motivation coming into this season?
Well, that's why I asked LeBron actually on media day was because, listen, everything about Cleveland was always, we got to get one. Let's get one. In LeBron's letter in SI when he announced his return, it was all about winning one.
You did it.
Yeah. Dan Gilbert's talked about one. So how do you re-up that? LeBron said he doesn't think he has to be concerned with motivating these guys. I'm curious to see how they start because, you know, Amon Shumpert is making crazy-looking videos for Kanye songs, and Tristan Thompson's out running around with the Kardashians. It's been a crazy summer for the Cavs. You know, they have enjoyed their riches, but now it's time to get back to work. So it's interesting to see how much I'm not convinced that there won't be a hangover. I tend to think that there might be a little bit of a sluggish
start.
We
went an hour and a half with no Kanye or Kardashian mention.
Sorry.
Thank you again for joining us.
but it's how they spent their summer.
Rushmore, and I think for him, as ability-wise, he's always been there. And you know, if he stayed healthy and the longer he plays, the numbers are going to be there. And then everybody says, well, he has to have the rings. He's been to the championships a lot, but it was starting to say, can he win? Well, he has three now.
It's becoming more realistic.
And you start talking about Kobe at five.
Right.
And you start talking about Michael at six. And others at four and five, other players.
I'm not going to talk about Bill Russell. He's not going to be part of this.
He's off the curve. Yeah. I mean, he has a chance this last year and the year before to elevate this Cleveland team with all the pressure on himself coming back. He doesn't win a championship. It doesn't look like it goes well for him being able to come return back to Cleveland. Now, you talk about a guy who could go 4 or 5 years at those levels, where he's playing numbers-wise, and that could be 3 or 4 more championships.
Right.
Possible.
How realistic does it become now? Because, like you said, we have always had that conversation when it comes to LeBron. Can he get those rings? Can he chase Kobe or MJ for the number of championships? But he's 31, going to be 32 in December. How many more chances does he have?
Well, I think for him, it's the way he looks and the way he's been playing, and then the emergence of Kyrie and others like Tristan Thompson and Kevin Love. If a couple more years.
Hungry.
We're hungry, and we want to get a chance to win it. And along with LeBron James, you see, have more guys with some voices to be able to go at some of these younger guys.
He's laughing a lot more than we're used to seeing him, I believe, in training camp. And I think that's one of the differences this season. We've asked everybody that's come in here to sit next to us, what is the difference between this year and last? A great point that was made that they're not necessarily lax, they're just relaxed. But I think it's the sense of accomplishment around here.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it was hard fought. It was so much chatter, a lot of negative chatter about the Cleveland Cavaliers in the league, maybe exception of the Golden State Warriors when they won it. But after that, it's usually the Spurs, the Heat, Chicago back in the day, 3 or 4 years to play at a high, high level. And Tristan Thompson, like you said, is a young guy. And then you can see those old guys in Frye and Richard Jefferson talking to some of those young guys, Tristan Thompson, and the guy who's kind of been around, Kevin Love, just a great mixture of guys.
How then do you avoid the championship hang?
I think for them is you know, being able to attention to details and understand it's not going to come easily for them. And then when they're going to hit some adversity, how they handle it, they're equipped. They've had a lot of adversity before. And then Mike Dunleavy, trying to quickly get him activated, I think he'll be fine as well.
I always had a love-hate relationship with these last couple of minutes of practice when you have to get however many more shots up because your legs are done, your arms are done, you're thinking about having to come back here in just a few hours for another practice. But how important are these final minutes we're watching of shooting practice?
You got to stay with your routine, whether you're tired or not, unless you're injured. You got to come out here and go through your routine. You got to be able to shoot the basketball and make shots and be able to look at it and say, hey, I'm still making shots when I'm tired, especially after end of practice. You got to make those free throws. Nobody shoots free throws unless it's the start of the game. Crunch time free throws are at the end of the games when you're tired. Well, I think for me is the way it was going so smoothly. T. Lou and his coaching staff has a game. Things is not going well. These guys talked a little bit. Things went perfectly. They were on the clock. They got through what they wanted to, and T. Lou wasn't upset about the effort and those guys mentally staying in tune. So everything went well so far in this first two hours for the Cavs.
Speaking of T. Lou, I have been told he's going to come join us momentarily. We'll go to break and come right back here to the Cleveland Clinic courts as Cavaliers Real Training Camp continues and starts to wrap up here in Cleveland. You're watching live on NBA TV.
Basketball fan, but I tell a lot of young guys, young players, high school, middle school, and college, and the Cavs beat the Warriors, but everybody stayed locked in. That's what I loved about it.
If you're simply a basketball fan, that series in its entirety is a beautiful one to watch, whether or not you have a vested interest in either one of the teams. But the guy sitting down next to us right now does have quite the vested interest in one of those two teams. Cleveland Cavaliers head coach Ty Lue, thanks for taking the time.
Yes, Ron and Kyrie are two of the best one-on-ones, posting Kevin Moore. And, you know, the guys did a great job last year just buying in. You know, when LeBron, Kyrie, and Kevin got on the same page and understood what they need from each other every single night, then I thought our team really turned around.
And this is day three that we're actually back at this facility. What, though, is the mentality? What is the mind accomplishment?
Yeah, they feel great about what happened last year. But last year is over. But, you know, when you win a championship, you always have Kyrie going to win the gold this summer. You know, K-Love took a week off and had our training with him the whole summer in Utah working out.
And you're talking Jordan McRae maybe playing some of that position.
I think they'll do it by committing until we figure it out. I think Shump can play some backup point, you know, but having LeBron on the floor.
The courts have somewhat cleared behind us, which means these guys are off to what?
Ice. Rehab.
Shower. And come right back.
Yes.
They've got a two-a-day. We don't, though. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Real Training Camp from the Cleveland Clinic courts. He's the NBA champion, Steve Smith. I am Kristen Ledlow. Here's a couple of highlights. I like it. Thanks for joining us live on NBA TV from Cleveland. That'll do it from Ohio.